How many of you have gone to small schools, particularly one room? Okay, this is my wheelhouse, so this is good. This is a good thing. So my name is Jason Clayworth, and I've been a reporter at the Register since 98. And my primary responsibilities is as an investigative reporter. So this is a project that's a little bit outside of what I typically do in my general beat, but we felt like this was a story that needed to be told. And I grew up in a really small district. Had between the all kindergarten through 12 grades, it had something like 365 students. Now it has under 200. So you can see what's happened to the little district that I grew up in southern Iowa. This project came to light because as myself and other reporters were driving around Iowa for other assignments, we noticed a large number of towns that were drying up and dying. And we struggled with how to tell that story. We've told it in bits and pieces, but not comprehensively. And so we decided that to do that, we would tell the story through the lens of school districts. And the reason why is because almost every town that we noticed that is dying had a common thread, and that is a school district that is closed. And so we took our cameras out and started filming. We focused on two different school districts, and you'll see this in the documentary. And what happened is one of them closed its doors for good, and the other one, another district that merged with a nearby district, both because of losing student population as well as budgetary struggles. It's common throughout the entire state. Every county has had dozens of schools that have closed. Iowa at one point had more than 13,000 different schools, and that was, and the documentary will go into the reasons why. Today we have, in terms of districts, we have less than 360. So you can see what's happened, and the documentary will go into this. I'll go ahead and start, and feel free to ask me questions at the end.
This is what it looks like when a small school district dismisses class for the last time.
Beautiful! You better send that to me.
Like,
why did
you
sell me
the
book?
I don't know, they're wags though. I don't know.
It's hard. It's not about the building, it's about the people. The kids, the people, the staff, the students that you get to know here. And unless you've worked in a small school, you don't understand that. So today is going to be a hard, hard, hard day.
Corworth Wesley, a district in northern Iowa, dismissed its last class on May 29th. It is the 4,315th Iowa school district to shutter since 1950 in a systematic institutional loss that has affected nearly every state in the nation.
Bye!
The United States had about 120,000 public school districts in 1930. Today, there are fewer than 20,000, according to research from the National Education Policy Center. School closures may be the norm, but that doesn't ease the impact felt by people in thousands of communities across Iowa and the nation.
Think of the girl has a screw. I mean, that's how old this is.
Keith Hosworth. There's a board president's name in that one.
Yeah.
I spent two-thirds of my life in this building. Been through some really good times and some really bad times. But it's been like family. Just can't.
Follow the Des Moines Register's year-long Lost Schools project at desmoinesregister.com/lostschools.
Iowa has closed 4,314 school districts since 1950. And now, as Iowa races for more closures, educators and lawmakers alike are asking, can technology save schools? Two key items of discussion about the issue
center on the need for Iowa to obtain high-speed internet in all areas of the state and the extent to which online learning should be permitted.
Education is no longer isolated in a particular classroom. I mean, education can be anywhere. Teaching and learning can be anywhere. And right now, there is such fear in the state of Iowa that it's polarizing.
Carver on April 19th connected lawmakers with his students via high-speed internet connection at the Capitol. A 189-mile commute to northern Iowa made in nanoseconds. The district already supplements its curriculum with online instruction. Carver's presentation was to help lawmakers envision expanded use of the internet. Debate about two online for-profit schools that currently educate about 700 K-12 students in Iowa continues. Advocates like Carver believe Iowa schools can and should play a greater role in using technology and are asking lawmakers to help make that happen.
My fear is that we're going to miss an opportunity to become the global leader for education.
Lawmakers are listening, promising further debate on the issue. Representative Patty Ruff, a Democrat of McGregor, represents Clayton Ridge, one of two schools in Iowa that has partnered with for-profit schools and offer online education.
There's so many different things I think we need to think out of the box when it comes to a rural district and how to keep the doors open.
Read more online at DesMoinesRegister.com.
That's the trend, and we see it all over. It's just devastating as far as the rural population is concerned. State decided that we shouldn't, this district should go, and it was, three or four years we battled back and forth with the state, you know, one way. So it was just a battle, but it was the beginning of the trend of the consolidation of the rural schools. You drive down the road here, and farm after farm is gone, you know, and no buildings, no fence rows, you know, and people don't realize that you get out there in the city and you get out to driving in a rural area, and that's just a trend, and I don't see any way that it's gonna change. So here's something that will never happen again. A Corwith Wesley Laverne High School graduation. The graduates, all 13 of them, walked across the stage May 17th, marking the last commencement before the school becomes Iowa's 4,315th school district to be shuttered since 1950.
As the final graduating class from CWO, today is very bittersweet. But today is not an end. Today is our new beginning. Congratulations to my fellow classmates. It has been really great growing and learning with every one of you.
Though we are all going our separate ways, I know that somehow we will all stay connected. Kara will be a Cornhusker. Star will be a Jackrabbit. Esden will be a Cyclone. Shayla will be a Warrior. But forever and always, we will all be Panthers. Thank you.
Corwith Wesley's last class is May 29th. Find full coverage online at DesMoinesRegister.com/lost schools.
We should get our priorities in the right order. The reason I say that because why now is Iowa not number one in literacy? I don't think any teacher should be starting a job. Yes, right here in Iowa, an elementary teacher should be getting $50,000-$60,000 a year minimum, in my opinion. Now, I know there might be a lot of people who want to say, well, we don't like Simon Estes anymore. But they need to think what is important, to have teachers who can make a living and support their family without having to borrow money or all these sorts of things. And what are they doing? They're giving nourishment, academic nourishment to the minds of our children. So shouldn't they be paid a decent wage?
Amish children in 1965 fled school and law enforcement officers who intended to enforce Iowa's compulsory public education laws. The emotional scene was captured on film, and the images were published nationally, resulting in a religious rights movement. Iowa lawmakers ultimately exempted Amish from laws that require most children to attend public schools. In recognition of that 50th anniversary, the Register spoke with two key people involved in that case. These are their stories. Andy Raber was 9 years old in 1965 and one of the students who fled the Hickory Grove School in the iconic photo that generated national response.
Yeah, I must have been 9 years old at that time. I remember going to school that morning. We knew at that time that they was going to come out and pick us up at the schoolhouse at that day to take us into town. And our parents had told us not to go. They had stopped at the first school and they didn't get anybody there, so they stopped down here at Hickory Grove School. The bus was there, plus there was Sheriff Department was there. All the kids were out of the schoolhouse, and then one father says, just yell, run, which we did. And everybody ran. There's one older scholar that they caught him. Except there was one little first grader girl that they caught. They actually put those on the bus. They did not take them to town. They brought them back in. They let them go and they come back in again because the parents would not accept that. They would not. You're not going to take those two to town. Yes, we were scared. So we run to the cornfield and we run back to the timber. And by that time it was noontime. So we went all back to school again because everybody was gone. I think it was the right thing to do. I, for my part, don't think I would want my children going to these high schools, big schools, where you've got, 50 or 100 kids together. We don't use a computer in school. We don't even use a calculator in school. We try to teach the three R's, which is reading, writing, and arithmetic. Well, for one thing, they were teaching a lot of things that we weren't used to being taught, And as of now, we teach our kids in school today, they do a prayer before school, and they'll do a prayer at lunchtime. That wouldn't be accepted in town, would it? Those are just a few things,
The battle between the Amish and Buchanan County and Iowa school officials began years before the 1965 incident. Some Amish parents served jail time for refusing to send their children to public school. Iowa Governor Harold Hughes requested a moratorium on compulsory education for Amish soon after the 1965 incident.
Our parents had been forced to pay fines for not sending kids to Hazleton School. They refused to pay the fines. So on a Sunday in church, the officers come to church and took our fathers to Independence to the jail. That's where they spent Sunday night and Monday. And I know of them not paying their fines, and they had come out and seized hogs, fat hogs, to pay for the fine. Somebody from whoever, he had never idea, paid his fine. And I know my dad always figured it was Governor Hughes himself.
Arthur Sensor is the former superintendent of Old Wines Community School District. He championed the public school integration as he was instructed to do by state and local education officials.
The Amish in number schools 1 and 2 had, from 1947 on, they had maintained their schools with a certified teacher. In later years, they did away with their certified teachers and hired their own. And they did that because of cost. They had no objection to certified teachers if somebody else would pay them. But when the teachers were no longer available, they had to have degree teachers. And then they're talking about several times the salary. Then they intended, at that time, they just put their own teachers in, their own eighth grade graduates. And then the Department of Public Instruction and the Buchanan County, they decided that we, Owine, should enforce the school rules. That's how it all started, yeah. And I give you the exact dates there when I got the letters from the State Department, and everybody was aboard and said, yeah, those poor kids are not having an adequate education, and you should make them go to school. And so that's what I tried to do.
Amish, particularly the older order Amish, don't generally teach science or current events in school. It's among the reasons there was pressure from Iowa's education leaders in 1965 for Amish to attend public school.
I thought it was a good idea and necessary because I didn't understand the Amish at that time. I had very little contact with them. I didn't know them personally. Later, I went to magistrate's court 18 or 20 times and testified against them, and they were fined for not sending their kids to a proper school. And every time some outside organization paid their fine, and I got to know these people well, and I came to realize that there was no way that they were going to send their kids to a public school. In fact, I will tell you that I now believe that if I had said to the parents, you're either going to send your kids to the public schools maintained by Owine and Hazleton, or you're going to be shot, they would have stood there and let themselves be killed. Dan Borntrager, who was not the bishop, but he was the leader of the schools, said to me, just get this now, I will tell you verbatim. He said to me, our way of life depends upon our kids not being educated. And that tells the whole story.
Sensor has saved more than 100 letters sent to him from across the nation. The majority were critical of his role in pursuing compulsory education of the Amish.
Here's one. Dear Mr. Sensor, the action that you have taken is deplorable. The Amish people, I am in agreement with, because the county was founded for religious freedom. The belief of educating their own children is a right of theirs and blessings to them. Who are you to judge what is right for their children? Our forefathers will look upon you with scorn. You have brought more shame on your fellow Americans by your Gestapo actions than Oswald did. Is this United States or isn't it?
You know, if you were to go back in time to 1965 and you were instructed that you had to make these children go to school as you were,
yeah,
what would your reaction be now? Would you just refuse?
I would have sat down with the Board of Education and would have said, this is an unreasonable thing. We're not going to be able to accomplish this. If my board had not agreed with me, I would have resigned and found another job.
Read more online at DesMoinesRegister.com. This school building will be demolished, probably within the next year. The decision, made June 16th in a unanimous vote by the Clayworth Wesley School Board, marks the end of an era for this rural community.
I'm just not sure it's a responsible use of money to save it. I agree that I don't want to squash economic development either. But energy efficiency, new structure, you know, I think we can do something better with the new building.
Corwith's last class was May 29th. It closed after years of dwindling student counts and tight budgets. Residents have been divided about what should happen to the empty building. Former Clayworth resident Rebecca Waltman asked the school board to table the decision for a year while she and others put together a plan to rehab and reuse the building.
This is our future, and it's a different future than what we will see if we don't step up to the plate and at least be creative about how to make something like this happen.
Really like the idea that there is a way to buy time for all options, and I mean solid options. Nobody wants a broken down building standing here, so that is a major concern.
You guys did a great job. I know each and every one of you personally. I did business with you as a school board, you know, Moen and so forth. You know, I thank you for that. But Mom, I think you're wrong. I think we've got the cart ahead of the horse. How long have we known this? 3 years now that this was gonna... We should have been having this meeting 3 years ago. Not now.
The town's loss of its school is anything but unique. Clayworth Wesley is the 4,315th Iowa school district to shutter since 1950.
It's not going to be the last building I close as a soup. Or the last building I have to take down, or no. It's not the way Iowa's going. And until, down at the state level, you know, we do something to turn the tide in rural Iowa. You know, rural Iowa, to me personally, and I live in rural Iowa, I think the state's focused on the big communities. There's not a whole lot of focus on us out in rural, you know. You talk about the plight of the farmers back in the 80s, you know, when farm prices crashed and stuff like that. There's a problem out in the rural areas now, you know. We can attract businesses. We're struggling to get people to move out here, you know.
What can the state do?
I don't know. I suppose if I had those answers, I'd run for governor, but I don't really know, you know.
Read more and follow this story online at DesMoinesRegister.com/lost schools. Following a summer where more than a dozen public school districts underwent mergers, Iowa began the 2014-2015 school year with more children and fewer districts and buildings. It's part of a century-old trend. In 1894, Iowa had a whopping 13,433 schoolhouses, most of which were one room and considered to be their own district. Now, there are 338 districts. That's 29 fewer than a decade ago. More burdens have approached as mostly rural school districts with fleeting enrollment struggle with more financial pressures, leaving some Iowans to predict that more district dissolutions are on the horizon.
I don't know if there's any good advice. You know, I try to take it all positive, you know, look for the positives in it, but it's a heartbreaker. It's tough. Especially when, you know, her dad and I grew up here too, and I think that has a lot to do with some of it. You know, this was our hometowns too, and we feel like we're giving that up.
This year, the Des Moines Register will be taking you inside schools and communities that are on the forefront of this trend and bring you an in-depth documentary to be aired in the summer of 2015.
It can become something marvelous, or we can pick it apart and be afraid and withdraw and implode.
Follow the project and even record your own Iowa school memory online at DesMoinesRegister.com.
Then it should probably be demolished, because if you leave it set empty for 5 years, it will rot and it will become an eyesore. And I don't think that's the best thing for anyone.
The school will have the money to level the whole thing.
Right.
Okay. If you guys decide that it's in the city's best interest to do that and start from ground zero and build a whole new structure that's gonna, you know, serve the city, you know, we're willing to do that. We just don't want to put too much of a hardship on the city. That's our big thing. We don't want an eyesore, and we don't want a hardship on the city.
I drive by the Wesley building every day, and every day I kick myself that we didn't demolish that building when we had a chance to demolish that building.
In order to have done this properly and give the school time to get their decision made, we should have been having this meeting a year ago.
I agree.
We're way behind the ball on it.
And I don't think people realize how much social activity and social function that one building brings to this little community. And once it's gone forever.
This is an emotional thing. You know, everyone in here, you know, most of the people in this room went to school in that school. And the thought of it going away sucks. I mean, it's as simple as that. You know, the thought of leveling it just tears me up.
Reality is the city is shrinking, and we got to find a way to slow the shrinking. You can drive 30, 40 miles in every direction. You can drive through little towns, and you can suddenly realize, just by because of some decisions community leaders made at some point in time, they reversed it, or they did not reverse it, and that's what they've got. You walk down this main street right now, look what we've done in the last 20 years. It looks a whole lot better. Yeah, we got some vacant spots, but we're holding our own.
Okay, everybody. Sorry about that a little bit. Time for the auction. So if you're interested in...
Hundreds of people gathered here on Memorial Day to pay respect to the Clayworth Wesley School District, which will dismiss its last class at 12:30 p.m. May 29th.
It really surprised me at first and shocked me, but I feel really bad about it because it seems like such a part of the community.
$20 bid on this banner, and who give me 30? Who give me 30?
Clayworth Wesley is a victim of tight financial restrictions to Iowa's public schools that are largely based on student enrollment. Those restrictions, coupled with Iowa's changing demographics of larger farms and fewer farm families, have proven a death blow for 4,314 other school districts since 1950.
Pat, get over here!
Hundreds of trophies, sports or band uniforms, signs and banners were for sale during the Memorial Day event, used as fundraisers for community activities in Clayworth, Wesley, and Laverne communities.
I'm still emotionally attached to it a little bit because this is your life. This is your community. Sorry, so... You never know. I guess, you know, like they said, this could be it.
Read more about Clayworth's closure and about Iowa's systematic loss of public schools online at DesMoinesRegister.com/lost schools.
fall in Iowa, and the signs of summer's slow fade are now visible in communities across the state. The cool nights and colorful landscapes set the stage in small towns and big cities, as residents come together for another seasonal rite of passage. It's homecoming. It's that time of year when displays of hometown pride come in the form of freshly pressed t-shirts and toilet paper streamers dangling from neighborhood trees. School spirit pours from the gym during afternoon pep rallies and parades down Main Street, culminating with a football game on Friday night. And don't forget, the school dance. With school pride reaching one of its highest points of the year, it's worth noting that in some parts of Iowa, that pride is merging, and elsewhere, fading away. In Gowrie, this is the first year two school districts, Southeast Webster Grand and Prairie Valley, have combined their upper grades and as a result, held a joint homecoming. But at Clayworth Wesley, this autumn ritual proved hard to let go. And when it came time to crown a final homecoming king, Esden Carroll emerged as their choice.
It felt pretty cool to be the last homecoming king ever, so. It's a week of fun, basically. I mean, last year ever, so. It's just a week of just going out and having fun, so. It's just cool because it's the last one ever.
Clayworth Wesley shared some of their homecoming festivities with Algona in a nod of things to come. But in some cases, the activities highlighted key differences between the two cities. In Clayworth, for example, students were given permission to toilet paper the community as a show of their enthusiasm. But in Algona, students were discouraged from such antics.
When you're afraid to give up control is when you have problems. If you give up a little bit of the control, let kids come to some of the decisions, kids will really think things through. You know, that's how kids learn. You know, you have to give them some control, and that's how you grow. That's how we all grew. So I think a lot of the things are, this is harmless.
Despite their differences and the unknowns that come with a shared future, an optimistic tone seems to resonate through these towns. After all, this is homecoming week.
Everything kind of ends this year, so that's kind of sad. But the really cool thing about all this, though, that the fellas, how, you know, and I guess I'm going with football team, even her volleyball team, Chloe's volleyball team, how they have become so closely knit, the kids themselves. I mean, they're Chloe on the volleyball court, you know, the girls cheering them on, all the CWL girls, the Algona girls, it's like they're becoming one team. You know, it's not, oh, the CWL or the Algona, it's they're becoming one team. And when Wednesday night's coronation was done, and all, the Algona football boys, you know, a few of them walked in, I know the parents in the stands and grandparents were like, who are those fellas? You know, who were they? Oh, they were from the football team. Really? You know, so a shock, a kind of how the kids are getting along so well. I mean, it's real, it's truly a cool thing.
These are the remnants of some of the 4,314 Iowa school districts that have closed since 1950. They're often called eyesores, and they're commonly cited as community blight. But there are some people who say that these vacant buildings can be given new life and, in turn, reinvigorate Iowa's rural economies. Rebecca Waltman is one of these people. She's a former Clayworth resident. Clayworth's district and its nearly 100-year-old building will shutter on June 30th. Waltman is helping showcase what other towns and cities in Iowa and in other states have done with their buildings, and she's hoping her efforts will lead to a statewide conversation and wide-sweeping action to reverse Iowa's vacant school syndrome.
School structures and bank structures and church structures and all of these things are actually infrastructure that can be used to support alternative business opportunities that may not currently exist there.
Some communities have turned vacant buildings into apartments, others into museums. Frank Siemens and his family transformed the former Boone Valley School into a hardware store and implement dealership.
I knew what we could do with this in my own mind. Didn't have it on paper or anything, but I knew what could be done. And we did it, and it's worked out fine.
But not everyone is convinced that redevelopment will work. The financial obstacles are too bleak, some say.
If you think that there's some kind of magic manipulation of the economy or you can do something to really change your region, you're probably wrong.
Read more about the ongoing efforts and debate online at DesMoinesRegister.com/lost schools.
My name is Charlie Litchfield, and I'm a photographer. I take pictures and tell stories for Iowa's biggest newspaper, the Des Moines Register. I grew up here. This is where I went to elementary school. Here I am on my first day. My parents still make fun of that picture. This is where my middle school was, over here, before they built this one. My high school is still here. It looks a little bit different, but so do I. For the past 6 months or so, I've been working on a documentary project with my colleague, Jason Clayworth.
Hi. I'm Jason Clayworth.
We're calling it Lost Schools. You see, in 1950, Iowa had 4,652 school districts. Today, there are just 338. Do the math, and that's 4,314 that have closed. As schools close and districts dissolve, we found that the history, the culture, some of the economy, and most of the community pride are all disappearing too. This is my mom. She'll come in later. My grandfather is James Edwin Pearson. He went to a rural school in Springville, Iowa, class of 1952. After high school, he went on to college, where he collected several degrees from Iowa State. He served in the Air Force as a navigator, where he wore these. Now, he's 80 and battling Alzheimer's. He's never been much of a talker, really, but these days he keeps mostly to himself. His stories of growing up on a farm in a small town or graduating from a rural consolidated school, they're kind of a mystery to me. Now that I'm old enough to be interested, my grandfather can't tell me about these things. So here's where my mom comes in. With her help, I'm piecing together the past and finding out more about my grandfather's beginnings in rural Iowa, which once seemed like insignificant little details to me. I've learned a lot, but I still have questions. After making a couple phone calls recently, I eventually tracked down Karen Taylor.
You were actually the town historian, is that correct?
Well, a very amateur sort of historian, yes.
We talked for quite a while, and after our conversation, I decided to make a trip to Springville.
Yeah, right. We could always do that.
She answered more of my questions and shared with me a detailed history and lineage of my family that I didn't even know about.
When they laid the cornerstone.
And then eventually shared some of her thoughts about the future of Springville.
The school is the heart of the community. And if we lost it, if we, you know, had to merge with some bigger district or they took two or three small districts and put them together, they'd probably have an attendance center for some age level here. But it wouldn't be the same as having a K through 12.
Preserving memories like my grandfather's is why we set out to do this project. The history of small towns across Iowa is eroding at an astonishing rate. And while there's no way to save it all, there's still a chance to save yours. At the Des Moines Register, we've actually created a website where you can upload your photos and your videos and share your memories of Iowa's lost schools. You can also connect with us at our Facebook page and find both Jason and I on Twitter.
I hope I can touch the sentiment that most people in these communities feel, and I feel it too, that sense of loss that might happen to some of these communities, and I've seen it already happen. As a songwriter, I'm always trying to get to that nerve that everyone it might not even be able to express.
It's time to go, summer's in, hold my hand as I go in. Ring the bells, class begins. It's time to learn a lesson. The teacher talks the days long past. How did time slip by so fast? All the memories may not last. May the glory days never end.
There's a culture that feels like it's slowly dying, and I hate to see that happen for the children that live in these towns, but these towns will be drastically changed, and I think overall the state's culture will change because of that, you know, and it all starts with the school, I think.
Well, that's not how it goes sometimes. Victory bell won't always chime. Sometimes you must wait in line, search for the reasons of the songs back in the day. All the children who used to laugh and play around this building made of brick and clay, whose pictures still hang in the hallway. Oh, within these walls we learned about life. Within these walls we learned fair play. Within these walls we held our heads high, but every wall must fall someday. But there's still a lot of life in these walls. Yeah, there's still a lot of life in these walls.
This is Clayworth, Iowa, a town of around 300 people who on September 9th voted to forever close their school district. That vote made it official. This is Clayworth Wesley's last school year.
I guess we knew it was going to happen sooner or later, but when it finally happens, it makes you the finality of it all. You know, all four of our children went through Clayworth, so...
Two of
our grandchildren.
Your parents.
My parents.
So you know, almost four generations.
But, you know, the handwriting's on the wall. You need kids to have a school.
The vote to close was a gut-wrenching decision for many.
Yeah, it's tough. You know, you put a lot of work into this school, and, you know, it's the centerpiece of the town, basically. And you hate to lose it.
Some said that at least under this plan, their elementary students will continue to attend school in Laverne, a nearby district that has participated in whole grade sharing with Clayworth Wesley since 1984.
It's one of these melancholy things where we were talking about earlier today. We really, really want them to vote yes on the dissolution because that provides the potential for Laverne to stay. If they vote no, which would be, it's like you can save the district by voting yes to dissolve it. It's such a strange thing. If they vote no, then the state will probably take over and then you lose all control over the situation.
Clayworth residents are now left to confront additional questions. What happens to their nearly 100-year-old building after classes end next spring? Should trophies, photos, and other memorabilia be saved, and if so, where? Will their local economy suffer from the school closure? And if so, what might residents do to cushion the blow? The Des Moines Register will follow the challenges Clayworth faces as part of a year-long project that documents the changes Iowa communities face as they lose their school districts to declining enrollment and financial strains. Follow the story and take part in an interactive Iowa school documentation project online at DesMoinesRegister.com/lost-schools.
Reality is, as enrollments decline and the way schools are funded in Iowa, it's based on a per pupil cost. So as they lose enrollment, they lose funding. So we're going to see a continued loss of high schools in Iowa.
I think it depends on how you want to apply the word crisis. If by crisis you mean, gosh, we may not be our own district and we may not be the Wildcats anymore, for a lot of folks that is a crisis, and I get that.
You know, it's pretty sad. You know, I'm thinking already graduation will probably be a tearjerker.
Those of us who choose to live out here,
you know, we're making the best of it.
It's an economic catastrophe. If a small town loses a school, they lose their community center. They lose one of the major economic centers for the school, and so it's bad news for small town Iowa to lose a school.
Iowa schools have been a source of pride for generations of Iowans. But for decades, the names of many school districts have been disappearing. Buildings that served thousands of students are gone too. In 1950, Iowa had 4,652 school districts. When classes started in August of 2015, there were just 336. According to the National Education Policy Center, the number of public school districts nationally has fallen from around 120,000 in 1930 to fewer than 20,000. Here is one example of Iowa's public school struggle. Southeast Webster Grand didn't merge or consolidate with its neighbor, Prairie Valley. Instead, officials in both districts entered into a sharing arrangement. Middle school students from both districts merged to attend school in one building, high school students in another. Before classes began in the fall of 2014, officials from both school districts retired their old mascots. They became the Jaguars of Southeast Valley. Meanwhile, a similar agreement in another district was coming to an end. Back in 1980, Clayworth, Wesley, and Laverne were the first schools in Iowa to adopt a whole grade sharing agreement. Sharing classes delayed closure for decades. But in the end, dwindling enrollment left as few as 5 students to a class. Clayworth Wesley couldn't survive. So by August of 2014, Clayworth Wesley district officials had drawn up plans to dissolve the district. Springtime graduation ceremonies in the town of Clayworth would end. Most of the students would go to Algona, about 23 miles away, starting in the fall of 2015. The struggles of these schools are not unique and have been ongoing for decades.
The state of Iowa was one of the few states that required that you had to have a school in a 2-mile radius. The average farm back in the early 1900s, we'll say it's 80 acres, that's 32 farms or 32 farm families that would be within that 2-mile radius. Back that versus today, you drive a 2-mile radius in a lot of rural Iowa, you know, you're lucky to have a half dozen farms. So it was just so much more sense of community where people really did help each other and there really was a neighbor in everybody's virtually backyard.
It was almost like a little community when you taught in country schools. It was sort of their social center. Just sort of one by one, they were closed, and I think in the 1960s was the final year. They built 2 schools in Muscatine, and the ones surrounding there were closed, and they brought them into the 2 schools in Muscatine. I hate to see it because I think there's nothing wrong with the smaller groups. I think sometimes the children get lost when there's too many, but it seems to me that there was more personal attention back when you had the little country schools. It was more like a family.
In Winterset, the whole town's talking. Outside the farmers' co-op, Ralph Hamm is saying that if the town builds a new school, it's the farmers who'll have to pay for it. At the Production Credits Association, farm manager Helen Kelleher warned school superintendent Lillard that the country children will suffer if their one-room schools are closed. But when Ed Barr comes to town, he agrees with implement dealer Henderson that if the country people and the town people want the best education for their children, they're going to have to do something, and do it together.
I say Iowa is America's country school capital. The reason I say that, Iowa had more operating one and two room schools for a longer period of time than any other state in the nation. And we have at least one preserved country school in every county in Iowa. So there are ways that these old buildings can be readapted and used, but it takes a constituency and it takes a group of people that will say it's important that we preserve this building. It can't be used as a school, but maybe there's other ways that we can use the building. And some of that is happening, but we have more examples of the schools that are abandoned and deterioration.
So we're putting a wall in here, and this will be one apartment, and this will be a second apartment.
I think there's a lot of good buildings being torn down that don't need to be. This is a concrete floor set on concrete pillars with a concrete roof that, quite honestly, when my kids are old and gray, this building's still gonna be here, and unless somebody knocks it down, you know?
I had superintendent once tell me that people would say to him, when the school leaves, the town dies. And he said one time, the town is already dying before the school leaves. It's just part of what's happened with the town dying. Will the towns grow? I don't know of hardly any rural towns that are going to do much growing. You know, when you have to farm 2,000 acres to make it anymore, you know, there's not a whole lot of farms out there. I don't know if you'll see much of rural Iowa growing to begin with. And I personally think you're going to see more rural districts look towards dissolution. When you're talking about spreading out a long ways, you know, do you want a child on the bus for an hour and 15 to get to, you know, the school?
As soon as I got here, I started looking at the books real close and where they were headed with their enrollment and finances, and it looked bleak. And I had told the board, about a year into that, 6 months or a year into that, I said, you know, you're gonna have to consider something different. Either Clayworth or Laverne, their sharing partner, who's been in front of school budget review every year for the last 4 years. You cannot continue to do that. The state won't allow you to do that.
You know, I went to school here. I graduated from this high school. And so the fact that the school is closing is, you know, it's sad for me. To be a part of this last year is, you know, kind of fun, but it's kind of depressing too, knowing that this year is the last year.
What do you say? We just don't have any kids. These rural communities just don't have any kids. I think on a Clayworth here, grade school right now, I don't know if there's 10 kids in town. You know, there's just no numbers.
My dad always said, he grew up in the school and everything too, he said, you lose your school, you lose your town in a sense. And that's sad, it really is, because that's what keeps you together lots of times. Friday nights, what do? You go to a ball game. You spend time with family in a sense. You know, you're there, you're involved in each other's lives.
I don't know, you kind of go in like it's kind of an honor to be the last class that'll graduate, but at the same time, it's like you don't want it to happen. You don't want it to close. I don't know. You know, it's got to happen sooner or later, so, because we can't just keep going like this.
A lot of the people that are from the Clayworth, Wesley, Laverne area have actually come back here to raise their families. They graduated from the schools. The grandparents that are here graduated from the schools. They're just very passionate about their buildings, their communities, and then all of a sudden it's gone. And I think it's just kind of disheartening for them to have to lose that spirit that, you know, you were a Panther and now we're joining with somebody else and we're a Bulldog and I don't know the people real well and I'm not associated with that community. And I think it's just kind of anxiety on their part. So I think it's just a little bit harder for the adults than the kids. Kids are easy, they're flexible. They just do what they gotta do.
Bye. Bye, sweetie, love you.
Thank you.
I think it's a good thing, actually, because, you know, we're all used to just having the same people, and I think it's good that we're starting to meet new people and that kind of stuff.
First whole grade sharing program in the state of Iowa with Clayworth Wesley in the fall of 1980. We just needed to. The two schools were getting smaller, and we just needed to get more kids in the classroom, and there just aren't enough people in the country anymore in the small towns. And that's what's happened here. You know, Clayworth Wesley had to close Wesley first, and then we just had Laverne and Clayworth buildings to keep open. That's just the way it is. It's unfortunate, but it's the way it is. But we're giving them a good education, and that's what counts. Just brings back the memories just by being here. Yeah, how we used to come out in grade school. We used to come out this door and slide down then off the end when it was icy. Jeepers. What a time.
So we're in whole grade sharing, and the best analogy I have for that is it's like an engagement. We're sort of promised each other, we're sharing resources, and we're working together to build a future.
It had to happen. I mean, you know, it's either that or else, you know. Are we going to wait for the state to come in and say, hey, this whole school district might be split up different ways? I don't know, you know. So, I mean, it's for the better.
I was mad at first, and I still am, especially with this whole schedule thing. I was pretty mad. I mean, we've been rivals. We grew up as rivals, but, I mean, it is what it is, I guess. You got to just make the best of it. I mean, but I was really mad. When I found out that we were whole grade sharing, I cried.
It's a heartbreaker, it's tough. You know, this was our hometowns too. And we feel like we're giving that up.
I feel that geography is probably the biggest factor with people's feelings about it. I'm fortunate, I live in Gowrie and that's where the high school is. If I didn't live in Gowrie, maybe I'd feel differently about it too.
It's up to what's in people's heads, because it can become something marvelous, or we can pick it apart and be afraid and withdraw and implode. We have a choice about what we become. And as you travel the state, you can find both.
small schools in the state of Iowa are really struggling, and it just come to a point where we had too many teachers trying to do too many duties, and the students were the ones that were starting to suffer, and it was being very evident that you couldn't continue to cut programs. We had cut as much as we could, and we had to come up with another option. And whole grade sharing, to me, was that option.
Holy bucket. Smile pretty. Go up there.
You know, it's a shame. It's a shame that you have to do those things. It would be great if we could rewind 40 years when every small town had a grocery store and a gas station and a high school. That'd be great. But we can't go back to that at this point. All you have to do is look at the great, you know, influx into Waukee and areas like that. People want to be in urban areas. That's where the jobs are. That's where opportunities and things are. Those of us who choose to live out here, you know, we're making the best of it.
When I walked up and it was the buses and the kids in their new shoes and new backpacks, I kind of got choked up. It was so complicated and long to get to this. And then here comes the buses and the new shoes and the bright smiles. And it was overwhelming, very exciting.
Juniors and seniors, you're gonna set the tone for Southeast Valley High School. People are gonna say, is this gonna work? And how you guys react, how you interact, how you treat each other is gonna go a long ways towards how people view this whole grade sharing. There's gonna be things that are new to me, just like there's things that are new to you.
They're offering a lot more now that we've combined, because we have more teachers, because we were sharing before, and now that we can all be in one building, it's just going through the process of getting to know each other, and I only have a year to do that. I was used to my class and graduating with my class, but I guess I'm up for it. I was gonna graduate early, but I decided to go longer to get the whole experience.
Full home, keep going.
Nope.
Come on, guys.
Can't do it.
The kids have made so many new friends. I don't understand why the adults can't do the same. You know, so far we haven't met a lot of the PV parents, but the ones that we have met and worked with a little bit on cross-country team suppers and things like that, they want the same thing we do, the best for the kids.
Okay, Ebony Scott.
Here.
Okay, Vanessa Scott.
Here.
We are just a microcosm of communities. Schools are just reactionary to communities. Sometimes people say, well, if the school leaves, then the town shuts down. But in fact, it's the opposite of that. The schools are 100% based on the amount of people coming from the community. We used to train within our communities and start new businesses in our communities. Most of our students don't stay in the communities anymore. I don't want the school to be blamed for that.
Well, the biggest story in Iowa is the continued and persistent out-migration of families from rural space. They're being driven out because agriculture every year requires more technology and less labor inputs, and that frees that labor to do something else. And where that labor ends up going, usually it goes to the next larger place. And those communities end up being the consolidating points, but it's a zero-sum game. It's at the expense of the remainder of the regional economy. As that process occurs, you're continuing to depopulate the rural communities, but you're also depopulating the rural institutions, or the reasons for the rural institutions, and that's where we lose our school systems. Slowly, over time, they just become unviable anymore, and a decision has to be made.
The plan to close Corwith Wesley was already in motion, but still required a formal vote. Residents were mixed. They wanted to save the district, but if they agreed to dissolve, they could at least guarantee the preservation of elementary classes at Laverne, a district with which Corwith Wesley had partnered for decades.
It's one of these melancholy things where we were talking about earlier today. We really, really want them to vote yes on the dissolution because that provides the potential for Laverne to stay. If they vote no, then the state will probably take over and then you lose all control over the situation. So yeah, I mean, I just really, really hope and pray that people turn out and that they vote yes and that they dissolve the district. And it cost me my job, but my job was not gonna be there a year from now anyway.
We knew it was gonna happen sooner or later, but when it finally happens, it makes you the finality of it all. You know, all four of our children went through Corwith. So, yeah. Two of our grandchildren.
Your parents.
My parents.
So you know, almost four generations.
But, you know, the handwriting's on the wall. You need kids to have a school.
Is that tonight or tomorrow night?
Yeah, it's tough. You know, you put a lot of work into this school, and, you know, it's the centerpiece of the town, basically. And you hate to lose it.
When my folks moved, when I was in college, we closed up that house in Humboldt, and they moved to Garner. I remember I was the last one out. My folks were out, and I was the last one to close the door of the house that I grew up in and lock that door. And that was and I think I'm going to feel a little like that, you know, that this is your home for an extended period, and that isn't easy.
Jaguar spirit is in the hallways, it's in the classrooms, it's in the community, and I think everybody's looking forward to a first parade between the two schools coming together to be Southeast Valley. So it's an outstanding day, an outstanding event, and I think it's going to lead to a great win tonight for the Jaguars. So, but it's really about celebrating our new school districts.
All of my friends are from PB, actually. Because they're new people, and that I don't have any classes with my old friends from SWG, and so I made new friends. You can't even tell like there's two different schools.
It seems like we're all just one now.
Yeah,
I think everyone's getting along.
Forget tonight at 7 o'clock, our Jaguars take on the Mustangs of Shenandoah, and I might see all of you here tonight. So I'm sure the football team and coaches will too.
We played each other the last 6 years, and all of a sudden those kids that you played against are with you. So, you know, it's just, you know, I tell people what we've accomplished the last 10 years together. There are memories on the walls, memories in some trophy cases, but it's time for the next chapter of all of our lives.
Come together as a team. Two schools join to become one. Come together as a team. Play like that. Play like brothers. Play like a family, and you'll have no regrets.
Here, we'll get on the bus. We'll go down. They'll come back and get the linemen. Okay? Jags on three. One, two, three. Jags! Everyone wants to know how this is going to work together. You know, did we gel? Did we put this together? Can we put a 2A football team together? So, you know, it's really going to come down to them. Realize everyone's watching you tonight.
big crowd here tonight. We've selected homecoming court, and somebody said, is there kids from each school district? And I said, I don't know which district they're from. So, and I don't think the kids know either. I mean, they do, and it ended up that we had candidates from both districts. We didn't plan that, but it worked out. So I think they've been fine.
Loss of three on the play makes it 4th and 17.
The kids adapt pretty well, and I think they're for this. They want this to work just as much as anybody, and they're going to do what they can. And I would say our football coaching staff's done a good job bringing people together.
Schools are an important economic piece, no question about it. Some of the best paying jobs are in a school system. So the loss of a school is a loss of the employment. But on the cultural side, it's really a loss of what I call local pride or local history. If you go into those small schools, you oftentimes see the pride of history that's reflected in the pictures of graduating classes from decades ago that decorate the hall. But you also see that in the trophy cases, either scholastic achievements or athletic achievements, where they keep those trophy cases that are important sense of community identity. When you close the school, it's oftentimes that identity. And I think that's where people grieve the loss of their school.
In a nod to the future, Corworth Wesley shared some homecoming events with nearby Algona. It's a partnership that will prove important in the years to come, as many of the students who attended Corworth Wesley will enroll at Algona when their school closes.
You know what? To me, toilet paper is harmless. The balloons in my office, harmless. You know, compared to what kids could do. And it lets them have a little fun. Everybody in school closings and stuff thinks that it's very difficult on the kids. It's sad on the kids, but the kids' world is not just here anymore. It's spread out, you know, it's all over. Kids will adapt, and they usually do at a pretty quick pace, you know. So sometimes it's harder for parents than it is for the kids. So we have a lot that are, you know, gonna go over to their friends' houses and stuff and after the parade, and that's what we want. We want them all to be as one, so we're okay with it.
So that's kind of sad. But the really cool thing about all this, though, it's like they're becoming one team. You know, it's not, oh, the CWL or the Algona. You know, so a shock at kind of how the kids are getting along so well.
It's a week of fun, basically. I mean, last year ever, so it's just a week of just going out and having fun. So.
even if it's not the school with the most opportunities and the best curriculum and stuff like that, it's what I've been through my entire life, you know? It may not be the best, but it's what I'm used to and what I've grown up to love since I was a little kid. So it was kind of sad when we found out that we were closing.
We still have lots of parents that want their kids still in a small setting. I think the parents have been pretty, you know, understanding that anymore, you know, it's just rural Iowa, so.
The emotion that we experience today with reorganizations and school closings are the same kinds of emotions that people felt back then. There was a sadness about it, and in the 1950s, there were 775 high schools in the state of Iowa. Now, that's a lot of high schools. That meant some of those schools were very, very close together.
Rural schools do not have to close, but we really gotta be smart. We gotta be different about how we do things. We're like the one-room schoolhouse of the 21st century. I think it's a function of what's happened with the economic vitality of our rural areas and the population dearth that's happened with the change in dynamic of the ag economy too. In the College Springs School District, you cannot buy a gallon of gas or a gallon of milk. And it's a pretty good sized school district geographically. So that tells you something right there. And I would guess 50 years ago, probably all those towns had a grocery store, had a gas station, had a hardware station. Somebody selling seed on Main Street. It's just, it's gone away.
In the months following the September vote to forever close their school district, residents of Clayworth continued to struggle with the decision about what to do with their nearly 100-year-old building.
They've been expecting it for a long time. You know, talk of the closures happened over a long time. I came back here 12 years ago, and there had been talk about the school closing. If the city doesn't take the land in the school for a community center, we would have to look for economic development opportunities for that land. So you got to look at those. If they don't have that kind of a match, they probably need to tear it down and sell the land. Otherwise, it's going to be a blight on the community, and the city will have to deal with it at some point in time. And with old structures, you know, time is their enemy.
If the city doesn't see any use for it, or cannot use it, or can't afford to use it, then it should probably be demolished, because if you leave it set empty for 5 years, it will rot and it will become an eyesore. And I don't think that's the best thing for anyone.
The school will have the money to level the whole thing.
Right.
Okay. If you guys decide that it's in the city's best interest to do that, and start from ground zero and build a whole new structure that's gonna, you know, serve the city, you know, we're willing to do that. We just don't want to put too much of a hardship on the city.
I drive by the Wesley building every day, and every day I kick myself that we didn't demolish that building when we had a chance to demolish that building. And so I realize I'm one person, one vote on the board, but I would have to be 100% convinced that if we sold this building, it was gonna get put to good use, that it'll get taken care of, because I don't want this community to have an eyesore like we have in Wesley from not doing what we should have when we had a chance to do it, so.
And I don't think people realize how much social activity and social function that one building brings to this little community. And once it's gone forever. And if somehow we could recoup just a little bit of that and use this building for ongoing purposes for the community, I think it would benefit all of us.
In order to have done this properly and give the school time to get their decision made, we should have been having this meeting a year ago.
I agree.
We're way behind the ball on it.
This is an emotional thing. You know, everyone in here, you know, most of the people in this room went to school in that school. And the thought of it going away sucks. I mean, it's as simple as that. You know, the thought of leveling, it just tears me up. But, you know, if that's the a logical thing to do, then that's a logical thing to do.
It's emotional heartstrings, right? If you've ever been in conversations about closing a school or consolidating, the entire community that's there went through that school. It's you're almost mourning the loss, right? So they're very tough conversations because change is hard and it's never going to be quite the same. In Iowa, the way the school aid formula works, if you're losing kids, you're losing money. And we, of course, require districts to operate in the black. And so some districts are going to continue to struggle with that as they are just losing kids. We aren't going to let them go too far in the negative before we're going to start talking to them about, consider other options. Could be whole grade sharing, could be joint employment of teachers, it could be consolidation, it could be dissolution. But our interest on this end isn't the size of the school, but maintaining the required minimum programming for kids.
12 rural Iowa schools appeared before the School Budget Review Committee, pleading for leniency from the state for overspending in their districts.
There's no other feeling of togetherness like a small district, but districts are running into money issues. You know, we have been underfunded for a lot of years.
Our parents, our community members, and especially our students have a very high level of anxiety about what's going to happen next year, because they don't know where they're going to be going to school yet at this point in time. They don't know if it's going to be Nishtabotna, they don't know if it's going to be Hamburg, if they're going to be, you know, going to another district because their school district is going to be dissolved.
We realize there's got to be some big changes, because I know what you're being asked to approve is a staggering amount, and we get that.
The challenge that we face is significant. As people have begun to understand the significance of our challenges, it really seems to be drawing the community together.
It's very soul-searching and gut-wrenching for a community to have to make that decision. Do we have a viable school or do we not have a viable school? And what we do as a school budget review committee is try to decide, you know, by giving them more time, is that going to make matters better or worse for them? Because ultimately, sometimes, you've got to say, you know, we think you've gone as far as you can go, and you're going to have to go make that decision without additional revenue.
All right. Thank you very much.
Iowa needs to relook at how they're educated. You know, the state, to me, should be the ones really pushing, really encouraging, helping districts so the sharing works. It's still a good education. No matter what, I firmly believe small schools have the best education.
As the number of school districts shrinks, the size of the districts that remain in rural Iowa expands. The average school district in Iowa now covers about 161 square miles. That's nearly 14 times larger than in 1950. The extra travel that is a result of the thousands of shuttered districts is a recurring concern among parents and educators. That concern peaked at Southeast Valley in January, following a crash that involved two of Rob and Lorna Scott's daughters.
I mean, I didn't realize that it was real slick until about the time that the accident happened.
I went outside to get in a vehicle to go, and everything was so frosted over. I started them, and then I called my brother and said, "What are you doing?" And he said, "I'm doing chores." And I said, "Come get me. The kids have been in an accident."
We drove that way every day. I mean, I knew it was slick, so like, if you're gonna be late, you just be late, because I was going too fast on ice.
I was just yelling her name, but then I felt her kick me, and then her stop, so I thought she was dead at the time. And so I called my mom, because then I noticed I had my phone in my hand.
And she said, "Mom, we've been in a car accident, and I can't get out, and I can't find Aaliyah."
When we were in there, I was just thinking to myself that I was gonna die because I was suffocating from the snow. And I just like tried to calm down my breathing, and then I was just out.
People said, "We can't possibly do that. It's too far and there'll be accidents and kids will get hurt." We're 8 miles from Ogden. We're 15 from Boone. If we wanted to, we could certainly send our kids that closer distance. And we've had a lot of people say, "Well, that'd be a lot easier." Well, There are a lot of things that we do for our kids that aren't necessarily the easiest thing to do. It's just what we think is the right thing to do, because the kids have had such great success in jazz band, in FFA, in speech. I just can't imagine taking them out of that atmosphere, because a lot of those traditions were strong in both schools. And then you put them together, well, you got to think, that's even better.
Two of the Vanessa and Aaliyah Scott were in a terrible accident, and they were coming to jazz band, and that is my worst nightmare. And the principal came in and got Bryce and said, you know, they life-flighted Aaliyah, and we all just started crying and praying, and it was just very, very scary around here for a long time. And anyway, so a portion of the proceeds is going to go to the Scott family for their umpteen million medical bills. Very well spent.
You know, small town Iowa, you know, when something happens, you know, everybody just tries to help in any way they can. And that's really, really thoughtful of our community and makes you happy to live here.
It often feels to me like there's so many aspects of this perfect storm that are coming together that it's hard to keep track of all the variables. You have the demographic stuff, you know, declining population, declining enrollment. You have increasing attention to instruction and the quality of instruction, and it's more with less, more with less. It's a very, very tough, it's a tough go. It really is a tough go.
Well, I believe that it will be quite a tearjerker today, saying kind of goodbye to, you know, something that's been around for a long time. The faculty, staff, you know, the last graduating class. We had baccalaureate on Wednesday, and the pastor that spoke talked about, you know, things that have a beginning and everything has an end, and tied it together pretty well. So I just think there will be a lot of emotion today. So.
Yep.
When people say, oh, it's so sad. Yeah, it is, but we kind of always knew it was out there. And now here it is, and you just kind of have to face that. And this is going to be tough. You get closer, you know, in a small school like this, so it's a big day for us. Hopefully the communities can still do things together.
Now we can see everybody.
On behalf of the students, faculty, staff, and school boards of the Clayworth, Wesley, and Laverne Community School Districts, I'd like to welcome you to the CWL 2015 graduation program.
Everyone seems to say their class is like a family, and we are no exception. Our class has always been and always will be a family. Graduation is no longer a distant reality. It is here. The beginning of a new chapter in our lives begins today.
Kara will be a cornhusker. Star will be a jackrabbit. Esden will be a cyclone. Shayla will be a warrior. But forever and always, we will all be Panthers.
I love you.
My little school stood bright and tall. Built our dreams when we felt small. Served us well through all the years. Say goodbye through our tears.
I woke up this morning feeling like it was last day of school, but now that I get here and I realize it really is the last day. Like, it was the last day of school, but it's the last day in the school ever.
It's hard. It's not about the building. It's about the people, the kids, the people, the staff, the students that you get to know here. And unless you've worked in a small school, you don't understand that. Give your mom a hug for me. I'm not gonna cry.
You have to put kids in the best position to learn, to be successful in the future, and hopefully we've done that here, and we served our role, and now somebody else has to pick up that ball at a little bigger school and take these kids forward. But it's very melancholy. It's very hard. The idea that, you know, the sounds that you hear when you walk through schools aren't going to be made here anymore, and that's a tough thing too.
Just trying to get through the day and get finished with it. You know, just one more, if you think of it as just like one more day at school, it makes it easier, but I wanted to just stay home, but I can't really do that.
I spent 2/3 of my life in this building. Been through some really good times and some really bad times. But it's been like family.
Phil Wesson and Matt Hefty, Jason Peterson.
You see so many small towns, once they lose their school, they just deteriorate away. And I truly, truly hope that doesn't happen here. Time's gonna tell. You know, everything comes to an end at some point, and you just have to go on.
I will miss the kids. I'll miss the classroom. That's hard. I'll miss seeing the staff and the other teachers. That'll be kind of hard to get used to, and that's why I don't think it's set in yet. I think maybe in the fall when I'm not coming back, then.
This hurts.
You'll be fine, you guys. We've taught you well. You'll be fine.
Clayworth Wesley's school year ended, and the community was still debating about what to do with the vacant building. Could it be a fire station, a community center, an agricultural school? Maybe it could be the headquarters for a local poultry producer. Renovation cost estimates were steep, and many of the ideas stalled. The school board held a final public meeting to decide the building's fate.
I'm just not sure it's a responsible use of money to save it. I don't want to squash economic development either, but energy efficiency, new structure, you know, I think we can do something better with a new building.
While it would be nice to see the structure stand, there are too many items that need fixing up. The boiler, will it last another year? What about the roof? And there is asbestos issues as well.
We've all talked about demolition, and the reason that's always been on the front page is because this school district has the funds for demolition. I'd just like to ask you what the conversation would be right now if we did not have those funds. Would we not be working for a common cause?
I think we just have to realize that we survived way beyond our expiration date. And it's me, I'm content with the fact that we did what we did, as long as we can do. It's time to move on and just make sure that nobody's gonna get a liability, that they're gonna get stuck cleaning up at some future time. Make a motion to propose a resolution recommending demolition of the Clayworth Wesley building.
I was gonna
So it has been moved and seconded to demolish anything left after
deconstruction.
We'll start with Tracy.
Aye.
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 I as well vote aye.
It's not gonna be the last building I close as a suit. Or the last building I have to take down, or no. It's not the way Iowa's going. I think the state's focused on the big communities. There's not a whole lot of focus on us out in rural. You talk about the plight of the farmers back in the 80s, you know, when farm prices crashed and stuff like that. There's a problem out in the rural areas now. We can't attract businesses. We're struggling to get people to move out here, you know. I suppose if I had those answers, I'd run for governor, but I don't really know, you know.
School consolidation is politically TNT. If you would have gone out in the late 1980s as an advocate for school consolidation, you couldn't have gotten reelected out in rural space. You had to be protecting rural districts at all cost. And so people are going to be very, very careful with the whole topic of school consolidation.
Legislative discussions on how to save Iowa's rural schools have not advanced in recent years. The 2015 session was extended for weeks as politicians bickered over future school funding levels. These decisions carry major consequences for all Iowa schools, but more urgently, for smaller districts that are already struggling.
But I want to assure school districts they're going to have a reliable, sustainable source of funding for the long term. And I believe the legislature should have approved funding for the fiscal year 2016-17 for schools. Actually, it's required by law. That should have been done this year. I don't want to see another year spent fighting over the level of funding. I think we need to focus on substantive issues and policies that are going to help improve education and student achievement in our state.
To think out of the box when it comes to a rural district and how to keep the doors open. It's something that we need to look at economically to try and introduce a climate in our small towns to bring those families back. Because when you speak to people that don't live in Iowa or they don't live in a rural area, they want that quality of life. They want their kids to go to a school where you have small class sizes. Rural schools offer that. But the things that they're lacking are the jobs and, of course, the connectivity in those small towns to make working from home possible.
There's not many places where the dominant trends are going to change. And so if you think that there's some kind of magic manipulation of the economy or you can do something to really change your region, you're probably wrong. The long game is education. The long game is that you advertise your state as having the smartest, most productive, most energetic workforce there is, coupled with honest government and high quality infrastructure. You see, you put those three things out there, those are the things that businesses need, but how do you sell that, you know, to a politician? You can sell that to businesses. Businesses like that stuff, but you can't sell that to politicians because they're thinking is that they can create jobs when evidence suggests that they can't.
Thank you.
Time to go, summer's in. Hold my hand as I go in. Ring the bell as class begins. It's time to learn the lesson. The teacher talks the days long past. How did time slip by so fast? All the memories may not last. May the glory days never end. Well, that's not how it goes sometimes. Victory bell won't always chime. Sometimes you must wait in line. Search for the reasons of the songs back in the day. All the children who used to laugh and play around this building made of brick and clay, whose pictures still hang in the hallway. Oh, within these walls we learned about life. Within these walls we learned fair play. Within these walls we held our heads high. But every wall must fall someday. But there's still a lot of life in these walls. Yeah, there's still a lot of life in these walls.
There's no other feeling of togetherness like a small district. But districts are running into money issues. You know, we have been underfunded for a lot of years.
Our parents, our community members, and especially our students have a very high level of anxiety about what's going to happen next year.
We realize there's got to be some big changes because I know what you're being asked to approve is a staggering amount, and we get that.
The challenge that we face is significant. As people have begun to understand the significance of our challenges, it really seems to be drawing the community together.
It's very soul-searching and gut-wrenching for a community to have to make that decision. Do we have a viable school or do we not have a viable school? What we do as a school budget review committee is try to decide, you know, okay, you know, by giving them more time, is that going to make matters better or worse for them? Because ultimately, sometimes, you know, you've got to say, you know, we think you've gone as far as you can go, and you're going to have to go make that decision without additional revenue.
So I'll just take questions if you guys have anything or any comments or anything like that you'd like to. What's the status of Gladbrook-Rhinebeck? You know what, I don't know at this point. I know that it was quite controversial a few months ago. A lot of heartache there, so I'm not sure. Does anybody in the audience know what the status is of the school district? Yeah. So she says there's been meetings to talk about the dissolution of the district. So there is a process for doing that, and it generally requires a public vote, which we saw here with Clayworth-Wesley. In the case of Clayworth-Wesley, they were at a point where their finances just weren't, you know, they just weren't making it work. And so the state has a process where when districts say that they're spending in the red, or deficit spending, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're in debt. What it means is that every year the state says a school district can only spend so much money per student. And it's so that the intent to that cap is so that education is consistent in all districts. But whenever you have a district that is losing a lot of population and a lot of students, They still have overhead costs of teacher costs and transportation, and so the fewer students you have, since you know your finances are based on per student, they just generally can't make it work. So Clayworth Wesley had money in savings. It wasn't that they were in deficit spending, but they were spending more than what the state was allowing per student, and they received through the years a number of warnings, and I'm sure this is going on in Gladbrook as well. They received a number of warnings throughout the years from the state saying, if you don't fix this problem, that you will lose your district, we'll make you shut down. And the state has done that in the past. They've made districts shut down. In Clayworth Wesley's case, the community decided to do it on their own, and that was simply because the district, the community members in the district wanted some say in what happens to the district. The state comes in and does it. The community has relatively few or no choices at all, and the state decides how the district is divided up and what happens to the resources that are left behind. So, and that's what's going on with Gladbrook as well. And you know, there's dozens of schools throughout the state that in the past year or so have received these letters warning them of deficit spending. So. The question was, how many communities are involved in Southwest Valley Grand? Okay, so at one point we had counted up 17, but I know that that's incomplete, because through the years, you know, each community had lots of school districts, you know, because you had every 2 miles there was a school, and so we just don't have. When we started this project, the state of Iowa had a list of 2,000 schools in Iowa that had closed. And we were aware from through the Historical Society, they had records saying, they didn't have a list, but they had records saying that there were more than 13,000 at one point, and the state of Iowa had 2,000. So even the state had lost count, lost the history of these. As part of this project, we started a website, and it's still ongoing, where people can log on and add their districts and add memories of their schools. We've had roughly 2,000 of those, so now we know about 4,000 of the 13,000 plus. People have also uploaded and provided hundreds of pictures. We have more than 1,500 at this point of memories of their schools and videos and pictures all up there. Eventually, that database is going to go to the Iowa Hall of Pride. They have, it's a museum downtown that focuses on schools in Iowa. And so that we hope that that'll be an interactive database and exhibit as part of their museum. And so we're working with them on that. That way the database and this material will forever be retained. The question was, is Stratford part of Southwest Valley? I'm not sure. I don't remember.
Stratford kept all by themselves, but I can't imagine that they're still existing.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I lost count of all the districts because there's so many that had merged to be part of that through the years. It's quite overwhelming. Anybody else have questions? The question was, do people have the right to homeschool? Is that what? Yeah. Okay. So we were aware, we didn't put this into the documentary because there wasn't a whole lot of this, but we are aware that there were a few families that chose homeschool. And so yeah, whenever these districts, when the districts either merge or close, that's an option for families. They have that option. Iowa gives families that right regardless. You have families have the right to homeschool. And so that happens, and it happened in some of these cases that there were examples of that. Yeah, so the question is, will they get funding from the state for homeschools? The state sets that, no, not necessarily. The state sets that up, and so the funding goes to the district that they're enrolled under, but a lot of times that's divvied up in different ways. It's not exact. The school district loses money whenever a child open enrolls, or not open enrolls, but homeschools. So no, it hurts the district. But sometimes they get money for like extracurricular activities and things like that. So it's not necessarily a zero sum game. Yeah. A comment is discussing about the emotions that go involved in these mergers and closures. We saw some of that in these towns. There was a school board member, the one that was crying on film. She eventually resigned. And so there were some hard feelings there. Yeah, and there's still hard feelings. You know, Southwest Valley, some of their school districts, I'm not going to remember off the top of my head which districts were which, but 10 or 15 years ago, there was another merger that in that district. And so we'd heard stories about there still being hard feelings there. So it lasted, you know, a long time, those hard feelings. And it's just part of what goes on in some of these. Yeah. We didn't focus on universities at all. We just focused on the K through 12 schools. And so, but I mean, the underlying issue that you bring up about large class size is real. That's something that that is a concern. And so as part of this series, the series involved articles. We wrote more than 24 different articles as part of this, and it's on this website. You can go and read that if you have access and see those past articles. But one of the things that we looked at was the student achievement in smaller districts, those less than 750, and those that have more than 750. And ultimately what we found was that the achievement was very, very similar. But what's different in the smaller versus the larger districts is disciplinary measures. In smaller districts, expulsion and suspensions are far fewer. And so you have a lot more disciplinary issues in larger districts. And so we did write about those disciplinary issues to quite a large extent. There are, you know, a lot of expulsions every year. So we see the differences there. Education-wise, differences were, you know, within like a 1 or 2% in all areas. There wasn't any area that was a big gap in any case. So the comment was in regard to transportation time, and particularly younger students that spend a large amounts of time on the buses. There's a state law that prohibits elementary students from being on a bus more than an hour. And that's each way, and an hour and 15 minutes if you're in high school. And so we, as part of this project, and we also wrote about this, there are districts in Iowa that have merged so much that they do not believe that there's any way possible that they can take on additional district grounds of district because they can't make it back in time. They already have hit that. What's going to happen after that point? Either the state law is going to have to change and allow these districts some exceptions, or in some cases in some other states, we've seen where there's a boarding school type settings. And so that's also a possibility. Who knows what that, as of right now, Iowa has not faced that, but it's something that is other states have. Yeah, this comment is in regard to class size and budget cuts. And so on the flip side of budget cuts and class size, increases in class size, there also, as you saw in some of this footage, the students have more options. So sometimes, I mean, it's not necessarily all doom and gloom. Some of these students have options that they didn't have before, advanced courses that weren't available at their smaller school. So, you know, there's a flip side to this as well. And you know, some people actually like some of the changes that are going on. The question is in regard to travel and travel costs and how it affects some of the sports activities as well. There have been talk, and as we researched and wrote about this topic, I'm a little bit surprised that we haven't seen more of a legal challenge, because you have school districts that are rural school districts that have far further miles to drive, and yet some of the urban districts don't have nearly the amount of miles. And so, you know, when you talk about that equity in education, I'm just surprised that a lawsuit hasn't been brought to challenge that, to say, you know, these smaller districts that have further to drive have to spend more on transportation, and therefore that's less in the classroom. So I'm surprised that hasn't come forward yet. But that's a real issue, the transportation cost, and that's a huge burden on the rural districts. So, you know, regardless of if you're in support of mergers or not, it is a huge cost that the rural districts are facing. It's a real thing. So.